Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, and welcome back to this next video. And this is the first video in the series of videos on the cancer. In this particular series, we'll be talking about the different type of the tumors, the important properties of the tumors, what are the underlying conditions that are actually responsible for causing the cancer, and what this term cancer actually means. Because when you talk about the cancer, we actually talk about the abnormal cell division, but not every abnormal cell division is a cancer. So it will be clear that this cancer, it actually refers to specific conditions of the abnormal cell division. When you talk about this cancer, the cancer, it's actually from the Latin meaning crab. Like the crab is famous for its stubbornness, as is cancer hard to treat. So the cancer, it is showing stubbornness to the available treatment. Therefore, it is given similarity with the crab. When you talk about the tumors, whether that is the benign or the malignant tumor, you will be able to differentiate between the benign and the malignant tumor in a while. But when you talk about the abnormal cell division, we actually use a term which is known as the neoplasm. This neoplasm, it is actually made up of two words. One is the neo, which actually refers to the new, and this plasm, it actually refers to the formation, the creation or growth. So this neoplasm, or we also use the term tumor for this neoplasm. So the neoplasm or tumor, that is actually an abnormal mass of the tissue as a result of abnormal growth or division of the cell. So when you talk about the neoplasm or the tumor, you are actually talking about the abnormal cell division. Now, why we call this as the new? Because this growth that is abnormal, that means that is a new growth. So this is known as the new. And if you have seen the movie Matrix, there is a character which is new, and that new, it was he was actually different from the other individuals in the film. So this new was showing actually some special characters, or some somewhat different characters from the other individual. So as are the neoplasm or the tumor, they are actually showing specialized properties in comparison to the normal cells present in the surroundings. If you define this tumor, or if you define this neoplasm, one of the famous definition of the neoplasm, it comes from the RA Willis, who is a very famous oncologist. And the RA Willis, he defines that an abnormal mass of the tissue, the growth of which exceeds and is uncoordinated with that of the normal tissue. This is one part of the definition, that the growth of it exceeds than the normal cell division. That means if you require cell division two times in the neoplasm or in the tumor condition, you will be getting four cell division. That means you will be getting excessive cell division. And that particular cell division is uncoordinated with that of the normal tissue. Like normal tissue, if that is dividing under the given condition for two times, this abnormal mass of the tissue, or this neoplasm or tumor, that will be dividing like four times or six times. So this will be uncoordinated with that of the normal tissue. Another important property is that this excessive growth, it persists in the same excessive manner after the cessation of the stimuli which evoke the change. When you talk about the cell division in normal condition, there will be a stimulus, and in the response to that stimulus, the cells, they are going to divide. But in case of the tumor or the neoplasm, there will be excessive cell division even after the cessation of the stimuli which evokes that particular cell division. Now, one of the important limitations of the RA Willis definition is that no stimulus is required all the time. Like when you talk about the neoplasm or the tumor cells, not all of the time a stimulus is required for the abnormal cell division. And one of the important example is the mutation in the growth factor receptors. So we will discuss that in detail, how the mutation in the growth factor receptors, that actually leads to the abnormal cell division even in the absence of a stimulus. When you talk about the excessive cell division in the human beings, for example, you actually see two types of the excessive cell division. One is known as the neoplasia, and the other one is known as the hyperplasia. Now, both of these conditions, the neoplasia and the hyperplasia, that is actually the excessive cell division. But one is this neoplasia that is actually leading to the formation of the tumor or the cancer, and the hyperplasia that is actually required for the normal functioning of the human beings. Now, what is the differences between the neoplasia and the hyperplasia? One of the important difference between the two is that a neoplasia that is not under the cell cycle control system. When you talk about the cell division, there are actually two components. One is known as the machinery of the cell cycle, and the other one that is known as the control system of the cell cycle. So the cell cycle control system that is actually ensuring that the cell division occurs only up to the required extent, and there is no excessive cell division. But in case of the neoplasia, the excessive cell division that is not under the cell cycle control system. I have a detailed video on the cell cycle control system, and I'll share the links in the description. So one of the important property of the neoplasia that they are not under the cell cycle control system, but the hyperplasia that is under the cell cycle control system. Another important difference between the two is that neoplasia, it actually divides even after the removal of the stimulus, and the hyperplasia, the hyperplasia cells, they do not divide after the removal of the stimulus. When you talk about the shape of the neoplasia cells, these neoplasia, they are not well differentiated cells. But the hyperplasia cell, they are well differentiated cell, and they actually resemble the normal cell. So as I've told you that the hyperplasia, that is actually a required thing for the normal functioning of the human beings, or the requirement of the human beings. So they are under the control system. They divide only when they are given a stimulus, and the shape of the cell that is very much like the normal cell. One of the important example of the hyperplasia, that is the normal hyperplastic response, that would be the growth and multiplication of the milk secreting glandular cells in the breast as a response to pregnancy. So the pregnancy is actually working as a stimulus for this hyperplastic response where there is multiplication and growth, or you can see excessive multiplication and growth of the milk secreting glandular cells, and that particular excessive growth is required for the future breastfeeding. So this kind of the hyperplastic response that you will only see in case of the pregnancy. So when there is pregnancy, there will be excessive growth and multiplication of the milk secreting glandular cells. Otherwise, in case of the non-pregnancy, there will be no excessive growth of these milk secreting glandular cells in the breast. When you talk about the components of the tumors, there are actually two components of the tumors. One that is known as the parenchyma, and the parenchyma, they're actually the neoplastic cells. And another component of the tumor, that are the stroma, and this stroma actually represent the supportive tissue, like the connective tissue and the blood vessels. And the role of the stroma is to provide blood supply for the growth, and it actually provide a framework on which the neoplastic cells grow. So when you talk about the tumors, whether that is a benign tumor or that is a malignant tumor, you'll find these two kind of the things. So these stroma cells, they are non-neoplastic cells. That means they are not dividing excessively. But this parenchyma component of the tumor, they will be the neoplastic cells, and they are actually the abnormal dividing cells. The important concept to understand about the tumor is the nomenclature, because this nomenclature, it can actually help you in differentiation of the two types of the tumor. One is known as the benign tumor, and the other one is known as the malignant tumor. And this nomenclature, it can actually help you in the differentiation of the two. So when you talk about the nomenclature of the tumor, it can be on the clinical course, it is divided into the benign and the malignant tumors. And on the tissue of the origin, they are also being given different names that will be clear in a while. So the first, we are going to talk about the nomenclature of the benign tumors. Now, what this term benign actually means? Tumor, we have already seen that tumors are the abnormal mass of the tissue, or they are the abnormally dividing cells. But what this term benign means? this term benign, it actually means like gentle disposition, the graciousness or the showing kindness and gentleness, a mild type or character that does not threaten the health or life, and harmless. So this all of these term that in actually refers to this term benign. Now most of the time these benign tumors, they are harmless. Most of the time, not all of the time. In special cases, these benign tumor can be harmful, but in most of the cases, these benign tumors, they are harmless. And I'll give you the examples in which times these benign tumor can be harmful. Now, when you talk about the nomenclature of these benign tumors, we use the oma suffix to the tissue of origin. So this oma suffix is actually added to the tissue of origin to represent benign tumor. For example, in case of the mesenchymal origin benign tumors, for example, this mesenchymal, it actually, this mesenchyme is an embryonic connective tissue that is derived from the mesoderm, and that differentiate into the hematopoietic and the connective tissue. So when you talk about the benign tumors of the mesenchymal origin, you can actually see the nomenclature like the fibroma. And like when you use this term fibroma, you can actually see this term oma over here, this suffix oma. So this oma suffix actually refers a benign tumor, but when you add this fibro term over here, this fibro is actually showing you the tissue of origin. So this fibroma will be the benign tumor of the fibroblast cells. So this whole term, this fibroma, it is giving you two information. One, that this is a benign tumor because we are adding a suffix oma, and we are adding this term fibro, which actually refers to the tissue of origin. So fibroma is the benign tumor of the fibroblast cells. And I hope you are very well familiar with the fibroblast cells, because the fibroblast, they are a type of cell that synthesize the extracellular matrix and collagen, the structural framework from animal tissue, and it plays a critical role in wound healing. And these fibroblasts, they are the most common cells of the connective tissue in animal. So this will be one of the example of the benign tumor, as you can see over here. So this is actually the you can see the fibroma over here. This chondroma, again, as you can see, this is oma, so we are talking about the benign tumor. This chondro, it is actually referred to the chondrocytes, which are actually the cells of the cartilage. So the benign tumor of the cartilage, that will be known as the chondroma, as you can see over here. And when you talk about the osteoma, again, this oma is a benign tumor, and this osteo, that actually refers to the osteoblast, which are actually the bone cells. So the benign tumor of the osteoblast or the bone cells, that will be known as the osteoma, as you can see over here. When you talk about the nomenclature of the epithelial origin, so far we discussed about the benign tumors of the mesenchymal origin, and these three are the important example of the mesenchymal origin benign tumor. One is the fibroma, the other one is the chondroma, and the third one is the osteoma. So all of these cells, they are actually derived from the mesenchyme. When you talk about the nomenclature of the epithelial origin, that is a little bit different than that of the mesenchymal origin, we actually use the term adenoma to represent the benign tumor of the epithelial origin. And how you define this adenoma is that adenoma is a benign tumor of the epithelial origin that resembles a glandular structure, or a benign tumor of the glandular origin that may not resemble glandular structure. So this definition actually seems a little bit confusing, but you need to understand this. Whenever there is a benign tumor of the epithelial origin, whether that is from a gland or that is not from a gland, but the resulting tumor that assumes the shape of a glandular structure, that is known as an adenoma. So as you can see over here, that adenoma is a benign tumor of the epithelial origin that resembles a glandular structure. Another important thing is a benign tumor of the glandular origin, if the benign tumor is originating from a gland, and that particular benign tumor do not assume the shape of a glandular structure, that is also known as the adenoma. But if the benign tumor is originating from a non-glandular structure, but that is assuming the shape of a glandular structure. That means that is of an epithelial origin. In both of the cases, that we known as the adenoma. As you know, that this adenoma, it actually means a gland. So it simply means that adenoma is derived from a gland. For example, the tumor of the adrenal gland, and you all know that these adrenal glands, they are present on these in the top of these kidneys, or you can actually see that the renal tubular cells, which are the epithelial origin, but these renal tubular cells, they are actually not glands. But if there is a benign tumor in the renal tubular cells, and those particular benign tumor assumes the shape of a glandular structure, that will also be known as the adenoma. Another important one of the important example of the adenoma is the Avelis adenoma, which is actually the colonic adenoma. It actually accounts for 5 to 15% of the colonic adenoma. As you can see over here, this one is the Avelis adenoma, which is actually in the colon of the human beings. Another important benign tumor is known as the papilloma. And these benign tumor, which have got microscopic finger-like projections from mucosa to the lumens. For example, these warts, as you can see over here, they are having a microscopic finger-like projections from the mucosa to the lumen. And this particular papilloma is actually caused by the human papilloma virus. So this will be another important example of the epithelial origin, and this is actually a benign tumor. So this oma, it actually refers to the benign tumor, and this papillo actually refers that it is caused by the human papilloma virus. Now there are exceptions to the oma suffix. That this oma suffix is not universal. There are exceptions to the oma suffix. For example, we use this term hematoma. So theoretically, it should mean that the oma is a benign tumor, and this heme actually refers to the blood. So we'll be talking about the benign tumor of the blood, but this is not the case. This hematoma term, it actually refers to the clotting of the blood outside the blood vessel, and this is not a benign tumor. As I've told you that benign tumors, they can be harmful based on their location. For example, the if the benign tumor is occurring in the blood vessels, if that is occurring in the neuron, and if that is occurring in the windpipe, in these particular cases, the benign tumor, it actually becomes harmful for the human body. So if you like the video, please subscribe to my channel, hit the like button, and share it with your friends. In the next video, we'll be talking about the nomenclature of the malignant tumors.